Can you give us some examples of the 2 to 4% null alleles that you found?
Yeah, I should have put the table on. You know, 15 minutes, it's hard to do the slides. Everything from autosomal dominant, non-syndromic, sensory neural hearing loss, Hox mutations with subtle limb anomalies, factor 11 deficiency, name an organ system, there's something there. And that's what I think is so interesting, is the incredible breadth and heterogeneity, which means that it would be impossible pre-Hox to gather the phenotypic data that you might want to have to answer the downstream questions. That's why I think we have to do it post-Hox, just wildly heterogeneous.
Yeah, Gail and Les, great presentations. I agree mostly. One concern is you both presented a case where you found an actionable item. I think one of the issues is in education. So how often do we hear a medical student misinterpret a negative result as meaning no future risk for something for a patient? So I'm wondering, I think there's a need to balance the presentations when teaching, and wondered if you had any comments.
I'll start, you can add. I think that's really an important point, and I will say one of the work that every site did, and then we worked across site, was what the reports look like for sequencing, in particular with respect to what the report is negative for, because a likely pathogenic mutation in BRCA is not going to be reported, only pathogenic as an incidental finding, right? So to parse exactly the language to say, hey, we looked at these genes, but we didn't look that hard, or we didn't tell you some things that we might know, and then how to look again, I think are critical questions. The education is not just medical students, unfortunately. I think we have our best shot with medical students. It's the practicing physicians that we have trouble with, and I think all of us in clinical genetics have had patients who had a VUS in BRCA1 or 2 and had a surgeon say, look, there's breast cancer in your family, you have a change in that gene, let's just do mastectomies, and they get done. And so I actually now, when I talk to the patients, I say, like, and if the surgeon says to you, you know, then you say, Dr. Jarvik says no, you know, because they will walk out, and VUSs are very poorly understood. People assume it's a changed gene, it must mean something, and that's one of the reasons we don't report VUSs for incidental findings. But the education piece, I think, is going to be much easier with medical students than practicing clinicians.
Well, I agree with that. I use medical students because that's where we have our biggest impact right now, and where we can educate. But my other comment is we also have to be careful that we don't educate students to the point where they think it's all in the test, and that clinical evaluation or physical exam isn't important. You know, we run the risk of no one knows how to do a cardiac exam anymore because they just say, well, we'll do an echo.
Right, and actually I think in some cases, as Les is pointing out, that you can have the converse, that the test actually suggests where you should go back and do your exam more carefully. And so we had someone who had a very disturbing looking in silico variant for tuberous sclerosis. So we actually went back to our IRB because we weren't returning VUSs, even if they were likely pathogenic, which this fell into that category, and said, gee, we'd like to examine this patient with this in mind. And I think your Hox had a toe abnormality that had never been really picked. The family knew they had weird toes, but, you know, the clinicians didn't really pay any attention to it. So that we will learn things by looping that way through. I should have mentioned that CSER just formed a physician education work group. We've taken all the CME activities across the sites and posted even national resources for physician CME. And we're just starting to work with American Society of Human Genetics, where there's a big push for physician education for genomics. So,
and I think, Val, your question falls into the larger realm of a discussion that we rarely have in medicine, which is an honest discussion about which mistake do you want to make. And it's something we mostly avoid doing because people love to sit in rooms and scream at each other one side says apples are red, and the other side says, no, you're completely wrong, oranges are orange. And we have a lot of these kind of discussions, and we don't really get to what you're asking about, which is what mistake could you make doing a hypothesis-generating approach versus what mistakes are we currently making in medicine with the hypothesis-testing approach, which is what we currently mostly use, which is a differential diagnosis based on a presenting complaint. That's where evaluating a presented hypothesis there. That's what we're used to, and I would suggest that we are mostly desensitized to the horrific limitations of that. Not that it should be supplanted or discarded, because I completely agree with you. It must not be. But when does that work, and when does a hypothesis-generating approach work? We figured that out for newborn screening. And we had that discussion with newborn screening, and we made a deliberate decision that we wanted a huge number of false positives with very high sensitivity. So we said we want to work up lots of babies for newborn screening, even though they don't have a metabolic disorder. That's what we decided, and that was a good decision. Now my question is, what mistake do we want to make here? I would say the trade-off might be a little different in adults and with genomics, and it probably will be different for each phenotype. A malignant hyperthermia and gastric cancer, I have a completely different mindset about what mistake I want to make in those two phenotypes. And so I think we need to have those discussions, and then that'll tell us when this will work and when we shouldn't use it. So I think it is the key question.
Eric?
Sorry. So, Les and Gail, thank you. That was great. Gail, I want to compliment the CSER program for tackling cost-benefit analysis. I think it's been sorely missing in this field. And I was very interested that it becomes quite favorable when you reach out and begin to contact relatives. And I wanted to call your attention. In the 90s, WHO led an enormous effort called MedPED for anybody who carried a recessive disease to try to find out all your family members who may have that. And I'm not sure what happened to it. The late, great Roger Williams led that program. But second, are you grappling with the LC aspects of contacting family members who haven't consented for research and how that's best done and who's the right person to do that? Because we've been grappling that in a number of our studies. How do you phone someone and who's best to do that?
Yeah, so, I mean, one of the things that's been nice about this program is we've been able to sort of bring our IRB along with us, and so things they weren't happy about 3 years ago, as the program's been successful, so they didn't want us returning VUSs 3 years ago, but now they're willing to let us return a VUS. They didn't want us directly contacting relatives 3 years ago, but now they see we have something to say to those people, so that's coming along. We are interviewing both physicians and family members. I will say, and you do family studies, I know, it can be really hard to interest the family, even when there's a good result. And we've definitely had that problem locally in Seattle. I can't speak for all the sites, of you have a pathogenic variant and you still can't get the family to come in. That's a clinical problem that we have as well. Or they're not talking to this side of the family or whatever. I mean, families are a really interesting thing. But I agree with you. We need to crack this nut. We need to figure out how to engage the families. And, you know, we've been talking, like, let's go talk to Ancestry.com and see if we can get genomic information posted there, because they don't do that. And I've actually had a meeting with them about that. Let's find different ways that people are engaged in social media and try and use that to you know, it's really interesting because we have big HIPAA controls, but people go home and they post their BRCA results on their Facebook. We should be able to use that to get the communication to the family members, but, you know, your aunt may not be on Facebook. So there are definitely tools that need to be studied there. And I think that study, Carlos did a really nice job identifying how important that is to the cost effectiveness. Do you want to add? Because you've collected more families over more time.
I agree with everything you said.
Okay. Dan?
Can you talk a little bit, both of you, about who the patients are who get into this, who gets into your study less? And across CSER, are they... you know, sort of asymptomatic, middle-aged, nothing people, or do they have a strong family history, or what motivates them to be part of this? Because I think it's sort of, you know, we were talking about before, it's this theorem-based, you know,
Yes, so we've actually done some work querying by interviews and focus groups with our participants to ask them that exact question. What are you in this for? What do you expect to get out of it? There was the kitchen sink for recruitment, newspaper ads, word of mouth, any whatever would work. So it's a very heterogeneous ascertainment group, about 20% with atherosclerotic heart disease, 80% without, but agnostic to every other phenotype. And so they are very heterogeneous, and what they expect out of it was about equal doses of benefit, perceived benefit for themselves or their family of learning some genomic information that could be useful for their health care, along with almost percentage-wise exactly equal altruism. They want to do something to contribute to the wider knowledge of how genetics and genes contribute to health. So those two things, which I think makes this cohort very workable for the things we're talking about, and that's why I think what motivates them.
So for the rest of CSER, for the most part, the studies are phenotype-based, so people with cardiomyopathy at one site, colon cancer at our site. But Katrina Goddard's project is preconception counseling, so these are women who present for, you know, preconception genetic screening, and as part of prenatal care, and then they're asked if they want to enroll in her study. Robert Green's project does healthy people, and they actually have the physicians return the results, and they record that to see how that worked, mm-hmm. Which is really an interesting project, right? Jim, I know you go out into rural communities, and so you're not relying just on people coming to medical centers. So there's a very built-in, purposeful diversity of the patient populations to look for, what works for everyone, what doesn't work for everyone.
Yeah. Amy. Thank you both. So I'm clearly biased because I'm part of CSER, and I think it has a tremendous amount of benefit. But I'd just be curious from both of your perspectives, Gail, from sort of within CSER and Les from sort of someone on the outside but doing a similar study. These projects were intended to sort of push us down the pipeline, right, into genomic medicine. And what do you think have been the biggest contributions of the CSER program and these types of studies to the field of genomics, and kind of what do you see as the major next steps?
So I think if you asked anyone in CSER what the biggest contributions were, you would get a lot of different answers. I do think CSER, just because of the timing when the program started, was very, very important in pushing back on the ACMG's mandatory testing for the 56 incidental finding genes, which was originally said, like, if they get a genomic test, they get those results back, wanted or not. And so the LC group in particular was very active in coming together as a community and responding to that. I think that the impact on the ACMG variant classification criteria has been substantial and will be more substantial. I think that the cost-effectiveness studies are some of the most important studies being done. But little things, how do you write the genomic report so everyone understands it? That's critical. And so some of these things are not very sexy, but they are essential to doing good medical care. So I really think that it has been a very spread out across all the work groups have done really important consensus papers, and the sites have done important individual papers. So I don't know, that's...
So I'll stick with the larger question and not the small one. I would say that what I think that we have done in ClinSeq, we set out to do three things initially. Number one was just to develop infrastructure, because in 2006 we couldn't even imagine what sort of an infrastructure you would need to do clinical genomics. Nobody had a clue, and the sequencing instruments weren't even available then. And so we thought we needed to build that, which I think was correct and true. We wanted to pilot how you could use genomics in a clinical research context, because I live in a total research context. I have, like, none of the CSER sites. I don't have any retail medicine exposure, and so that's my domain. So we wanted to see how that could work. And the third thing was to discover a relationship between genes and atherosclerotic heart disease. And I think we succeeded in the first two, and we failed miserably and relatively quickly in the first one, which is, I think, exactly what we were supposed to do. Try things, fail quickly, get on to something else. And what happened is the story I related to you, which is we looked at these exomes and we said, for goodness sakes, why are we limiting ourselves here to the phenotype that we set out to look for in the first place? We should use it as broadly as we can use it. And I think that's our big challenge. And I think that having that opportunity to pilot this, have some failures, and have a success that we didn't even anticipate we would be working on is exactly the kind of research milieu that we need to support, whether it's intramural or extramural. I think that's where we need to be. And so I think this direction that's taken us, not where we expected it to be today, but it's, I think, interesting, useful, and it will be fruitful for the field.
Yeah, I'd add we get a lot of queries across CSER about setting up the genomic sequencing pipeline and results return informatics pipelines. And many, you know, as we were leaders and people are following, we get a lot of people coming to visit to see how it was done.
So 2 to 4% was higher than you thought and higher than Gail's number.
Yeah.
Of those 2 to 4%, do you have a sense of how many of those are sort of important for their health care? I mean, weird toes probably doesn't count as important for your health care unless it means you sort of have to have special shoes or something.
Sorry, those are two different numbers. The 2 to 4% is when we wrote the ACMG recommendations for incidental findings. That was our predicted yield for those 56 genes. The 3% yield was the genome-wide null variant yield. So those are, but they're in the same range. Yeah, but they're
above the 3%. How many are?
Let me just say the difference between his numbers and my numbers really falls to the Ashkenazis, which he had represented and I didn't, and that makes a big difference. Go ahead.
But you were trying to ask a question there, Dan. I don't think you got it.
The 3% includes the funny toes.
Yeah.
And so what proportion of the 3% are funny toes and what proportion are, bad cardiomyopathies?
So here's a really interesting question. Is where is the boundary between a disease and a trait? I have no idea where that is. We drew, and the paper's in press, I'll be happy to send it to you. We drew what we thought was a reasonable boundary, admitting that we were in absolutely gray, squishy territory, and you could very well argue it should be farther left or farther right. I have no honest way.
But you should talk about the hearing impairment patient who didn't know he was hearing impaired.
Well, yeah, I mean, hearing loss is that's a clear one, cancer susceptibility, et cetera. There are some that are easy. There are some that are, I mean, PTC tasting and earwax consistency is clearly way over here. Where you draw that boundary, I have no idea.
If I'm remembering correctly, you had a not young adult who you predicted would have hearing impairment who said his hearing was normal and when tested.
That's why I like Gail
had
so
very
much,
bad hearing. Because
the guy's my age.
So
and
his
she
wife
said he's not
probably
young.
Knew about his hearing, but he didn't. So,
yes. So all of the above is the answer. Jay, you had a question?
I was going to say things along the same lines or ask about similar things, but does your study in particular, Les, does that lead us to any insights with respect to, if you just think, what fraction of people with Mendelian disorders have diagnoses? Like, is that, if 1% of live births get diagnoses and you're coming up with 2 or 3%, does that imply that 2/3 of Mendelian diagnoses are undiagnosed?
I would not go so far as to put a fraction on. Our sample size with 1,000 people leaves us, when we start, sift, we end up with 80 null variants, half of which had a phenotype and half didn't. Now, so you know better than I what the confidence limits are. They're big down there. So I'm not going to put a 2/3 number on it, but your point, I think, is correct. That I would suggest that there's significantly more out there than we think is out there. And my first case that I started with, the 66-year-old lady with combined melanic and methylmalonic acidemia, there she is at 66 years of age, bouncing around in her primary care doc's office with these vague symptoms. She has a Mendelian disease. We never would have thought of that 5 years ago. The genome told us we should think about that. And I think there's going to be a fair number of those examples, and it will vary enormously from different genes and different traits. I got in a furious argument with Altshuler at the Genetics of Common Disease meeting last year, and he said, your results, speaking to me, are impossible. It cannot be, I said it was between 3% and 6% was my estimate. He said that's not possible. And he gave all the reasons why I thought it was not possible. And I, respectfully disagree. I think it's probably not that high for diabetes. I think for other things, it's probably neurologic diseases, I'll bet you it's much higher than we think it is.
But not a new problem in clinical genetics. And so I saw a patient more than 20 years ago was an adult with lung disease, and I said to the referring pulmonologist, I think this patient has cystic fibrosis. And the pulmonologist said, if he had cystic fibrosis, he'd be dead. Well, he had cystic fibrosis, right? Mm-hmm. He didn't have delta 5-8, but he had cystic fibrosis. We see the tip of the iceberg. We think we know a disease, but we only know who's walking in complaining about that disease. We don't know the people who are out there. And actually, I think that's one of the real power is to understand what's under the tip of that iceberg, what's under the water. Eric.
So, Lessingale, we treat, for example, cholesterol or blood pressure because of the risk of future disease. Given your two talks, should we be treating genotype now and not phenotype?
So I was trying to be diplomatic about that, Eric, by saying it's very controversial and hard to push this out into the clinical community, but you've put a pretty fine point on that. There was a wonderful report from the IOM a few years back. It was called Towards Precision Medicine. That was important. And then the subtitle is A New Taxonomy of Human Disease. Right? And they are posing your question, which is to say, should we reorganize our taxonomic understanding of human pathophysiology with a primarily molecular focus as opposed to a primarily phenotypic focus? And that is a question that makes most people's hair catch on fire or their heads explode because they hate it. I was taught in medical school, do not treat the test, treat the patient. We were taught. And what I'm actually suggesting is a little bit of treat the test. That's elegant. I like that. I can use that.
Yeah. I'll fine tune that. And I'll say, if you have genes that predict blood pressure or genes that predict cholesterol, I want to measure those intervening things. But if you have a gene that predicts heart disease without some intervening thing that you can measure, you know, I see the day where there's a risk score that is useful, and I think we can generalize that. If you have the intervening trait and you can measure it, that's always going to be the best data because it's going to take us a really long time to be clear. You know, we're talking about average risks, so individual risks are a totally different thing, as you well know.
Awesome question.
You want to get Bob in the back?
That the payment system, the reimbursement system, is really good for people who get treated symptomatically. And not very good for diagnosis unless you're failing symptomatic treatment. So there's a large number of people who bump along being treated symptomatically who never get diagnosed.
That's a good point. Thank you.
That's the work that we have to do is to build the evidence base to convince people that it should be paid for. I agree with you.
Yeah, I just wanted to back up on something you said earlier, Les, about we figured it out with newborn screening. That's not quite true. We're still figuring out,
right,
particularly with expanded newborn screening.
Yep.
Some things we're finding out they're not really disorders.
Yep.
And so I think that needs to be taught. In addition, I really like your concept of hypothesis-driven, but that can't spill over into the clinical testing of an individual. What you create when you test an individual without a hypothesis or a differential diagnosis, you create a huge Bonferroni situation where you have all these VUSs and you don't know what to pursue.
It's a great question. And obviously there is enormous potential for mayhem doing that in an uncontrolled manner. There's no argument about that. But what I was actually surprised about was that my yield was 50%. That the disease was, I thought it was going to be much lower than that. Because if they don't have it, the variant shouldn't be that powerful. But it was powerful. And in fact, it's more powerful than we think it is. Because if you do the Bayesian analysis, it's telling us that actually, in spite of the Bonferroni problem, the yield 50%, that's pretty high. It's pretty high. And so it's not 100, we all understand that, but you know, some of these people, you change their odds of having Bird-Hogg-Debye syndrome from 1 in 50,000 to 1 in 2. That's a huge change in odds. And even though the first one wasn't 0 and the second one isn't 1, I'll concede you that, but that's a big change. And as a clinician, I can use that change in probability to direct the care of that patient in a fruitful way better than I can without that evidence. So I would say it is more useful than you might think.
So I'll condition and say, actually, maybe more useful than what happens to that, you know, 70-year-old person is knowing the range of implications of that variant. So when you have a baby with that variant, you don't say 90% chance you're going to have some terrible thing when it turns out that there is a big range that we just don't know about. So we have a very poor understanding of the penetrance of, you know, even the most common traits. And the approach Les is taking tells us at least the range. It doesn't give us the whole curve, but it tells us the range of penetrance. And I think that's crucial information that we need clinically.
Okay. All right, well, thank you both very much, particularly Gail, for coming so far. Yeah, he doesn't get reimbursement. All right, let's go back to concept clearance. Tina, you want to come up? Next on the docket is a presentation from Tina Gatlin. She's going to describe a data analysis and coordinating center for the training and career development programs at NHGRI.